in today. How are you doing, James?
Very good. Thank you all very, very much for coming. What a warm evening.
I'd like to open the conversation with a question of, there's a lot in this book. It's a very significant kind of consolidation of thought. It's a kind of lifetime of thinking. I know that it's always been very important for you to publish a book, like, and for it to be the book. And I very much feel that this book achieves that. But I wanted to start by, if you could talk a little bit about the most significant artworks in this process, because if, for people that may not be familiar, over the course of, say, the last decade, you've been producing things that I've often referred to as sort of prototypes to explain ideas that were not necessarily legible. And at a certain time we exhibit work, we work together, I'd be curious to hear about how those objects or those pieces of software fed into a kind of writing process and how that works.
Yeah. So there's a couple of things there, which is kind of why book and why now, like even questions and us. And so it's sort of, it feels like a very particular book, also say odd in that it's not the one that I ever thought I would write, I wanted to write forever. I always thought I'd write a book about the internet and it would have kind of rainbows on the cover, and I'm really glad that this one does. But at the same time, it's also somewhat bleak and not the kind of necessarily the quite as celebratory of that culture as I would have maybe thought it would be, which is partly a function of its time. I started writing it, I was given the opportunity to write about it, which are always happening. And so that coloured it to some extent. But as you say, it's also a product of working through a series of questions over the last decade or so, which are about how we represent things that are kind of too large for us to see. My work's often described as making visible the invisible, by which I do things like, right, because these things are never really invisible. Right, they're invisible to some people and radically visible to other people. And so that trying to negotiate that distance between the things, trying to understand what it is that we can see, what it is that we can't see, who can see it and why some of us can't, kind of forms the basis of this. Because for me, I've always been trying to use these technological processes to make technology more visible to people, and increasingly I found that those works weren't fully doing the thing that I wanted them to do. Primarily they weren't achieving any kind of change, and I think we'll talk about this. Paradox as we get into it, but there seems to be a paradox between this kind of desire to make radically visible these things, and then to say, what do you achieve by just kind of creating? And so the darkness or the cloudiness that repeats in the book is very much a reaction to that. That actually maybe this kind of visibility is not enough, and possibly even it's a trap.
Curious, do you see in the production of a book the possibility for a kind of more significant change? That the book, the way that information travels through a book, and you know, obviously the kind of the speaking apparatus of producing a book, because you gave like a TED talk a couple of weeks ago, the kind of potential of that platform, do you see a hierarchy in your mind of like the book having potential to be a kind of more active form in this moment?
Yeah, it's really. To say that the book is sort of more special, it's like to set it in opposition against other ways of speaking and writing and talking and presenting most of my work online. I value that as a way of disseminating. It's hard to get people to read 100,000 words on a web page, and also you can do things with thinking in a book that are not possible, certainly not in a 12-minute talk, not really in a blog post. I think all of these ways of thinking are valid. There's a book length thing. You can set certain things in conversation with each other that aren't possible. But then I hope this will kind of spiral back out into the network again.
And I want to stay kind of on the surface until we start, before we get into the kind of content. So from new aesthetic to new dark age, here's the gen. A lot of people liked the new aesthetic term. The contemporary art world didn't like the new aesthetic term, but more kind of in kind of broader context, it kind of resonated with something that described a kind of mimetic quality. New Dark Age is something else, and I wonder in terms of what New Dark Age is being described, and it's particularly used to describe the kind of oppressive nature of religion, and particularly the Christian Church, and that leading to a kind of intellectual regression as a result of superstitions. Whilst that may actually not be true, yes, a lot of questions. I guess my basic question is, why the New Dark Age?
Sure. Well, I think the New Aesthetic is actually always a good place to start, but I always enjoy that to talk about it. But the thing to say about the New Aesthetic is it came from a very specific place. So this, people who don't know that, it is an ongoing blog and research project and a kind of surfacing and gathering together of lots of imagery that I felt present, actually. One of the real things that started me off down that project was looking around me at the world and not seeing what I knew was happening in the world. But in particular, styles and trends at this point, we're talking 7-8 years ago now, but they're still fairly dominant. The kind of really stupid things, like the fetishization of kind of retro and all the kind of authenticity that comes along with that. The fact that we're carrying around basically supercomputers in our pockets, but everyone's going around dressed as blacksmiths. And you have like, you know, blackboards in cafes and this kind of like, what felt like a kind of total aesthetic rejection of the future. That I felt was sort of tied to a kind of fear and misunderstanding of the present. And so in the New Aesthetic, I started to like collect together things that to me felt like they had the sheen, kind of meant the surface of the thing, like this is what it looks like. The thing is, as soon as you've done that, as soon as you've kind of, you know, made, like, here's some things we can gather around to talk about the deeper effect, then we can start talking about the deeper effect, right? So, you know, in the last few years I've moved into, I've talked more about the things that kind of underlie that, things like a kind of global surveillance and the drone war, and like some of the pretty dark aspects of this, but for me were kind of impossible to discuss. We got a kind of shared sense of the surface of the thing that was under discussion. So actually it's quite a natural progression to kind of end, or to not to end, but to move through towards this thing that I call the New Dark Age in the book, which is really important to emphasize is actually, again, not really anything like what we think was the medieval Dark Age, in which also was not a Dark Age. Lots of stuff was happening there. We just lacked the records of it. We didn't used to have a lot of insight into the area, so we naively assumed people weren't like doing a lot of really extraordinary things then. A New Dark Age is crucially not a thing in which nothing happens. It's not a thing in which things are not possible. You quoted from Lovecraft on that. I also quote from, in particular, Virginia Woolf, who wrote in her diary in the early 1920s that she felt we were entering a dark thing, because the darkness was a good place to think. That actually doesn't need to be a frightening place. It can be a time, a place of kind of extraordinary possibility. And the darkness, the darkness is, I'm trying to set up in kind of, as a kind of time and space in which to think things that we haven't been very good at thinking about before.
You answered both questions. I mean, I feel a great deal of empathy with you in terms of having known you to always be an optimist. And you still are an optimist. It's still there in like the way that you're speaking and the subjects that you're addressing, but. And I have heard you describe yourself as a kind of recovering techno-utopian, and I would very much like align with that kind of perspective. Because this book, you know, for other people who, and I'm sure there's many people, being an independence, a declaration for independence in cyberspace, and, you know, being a part of various kind of activist movements, horizontal, you know, all of this kind of discourse, when there was a true belief that this was, you know, it was possible, you know? And in many ways, like, if you relate to that kind of history, reading this book is like a dark night of the soul. And so I wondered, like, specifically for people that have not necessarily gone through that journey and are suddenly, like, in this moment, kind of the kind of info wars that are happening through Twitter and fake news, blah, 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 I wondered, like, what were those like key personal turning points for you where you began to turn against the kind of message of technology that you'd been given previously?
Yeah, I mean, I'm full of possibilities. We've just lost control over it, or never had it. And also, who the we is in that, because not everyone has lost control of it, and it's definitely being used in certain ways very effectively. But the thing about vagrant recovery, I'm one of those kids who grew up on the internet. I had a computer in my bedroom before, you know, my parents had no idea what that was connected to. And that it was a huge kind of zone of possibility. And there's a huge danger there of then becoming a kind of old man of the internet and raving about how good it was in my own day, which I don't believe. But the turning points, I guess, are starting to see this thing as being a contested space, as a struggle. Like, you know, and fighting that narrative from both angles. So the fact that, like, slowly the internet became, you know, intensely commercialized, became intensely kind of financialized, became for most people a place of kind of shopping and social ordering, rather than a kind of space of experimentation and possibility. And slowly realizing how much of that was a kind of deliberate shutting down of this kind of it's potentially emancipatory possibilities. And so that if one cared deeply about, so I keep using this term, the network, which I prefer to the internet, because when I talk about the network, I mean like the internet and us as one kind of big system, again, because we always used to talk about the internet as this kind of like other place that you dial into, jacking into the Matrix, Gibson style kind of thing. And it just like, that wasn't, it was never that far away, and it was never that other, and it's kind of totally merged with everyday life in kind of all kinds of weird and interesting emancipatory possibilities of it. Then you kind of have to go quite dark, I think, to kind of frame it as a struggle, as something that actually is constantly being kind of renewed and redesigned and played out again, and that we need to kind of renew our commitment to it to some extent. And also, there's a weird kind of vein of, I think we'll get to this again a bit later, but a kind of faith and trust in this thing as well. I kind of play this game of going back and forth, kind of anthropomorphizing the network. But right at the beginning, I talked about this weird moment I had where I was sitting on my balcony watching all terrible things, The West Wing. And I was watching a thing that looped over from Jed Bartlett, of all people, when it crashed. It was like, we have the technology to get in touch with you in emergency. We have the technology to get in touch with you in emergency, right? And it was like my computer was like trying to get me to like say that like. This technology we built is not this complete sense of darkness. It also actually can teach us something about the way that the world is. Because the network is, yeah, something extraordinarily emergent in our culture that I still have this deep belief in, but I kind of to reread it, to re-engage it, and see what maybe it's actually trying to tell us more clearly about the state of the world.
And maybe to speak to kind of a specific example of that was kind of like quite, I remember it being, I don't know if I said it to you at the time, but it was like quite a profound kind of turning point when, you know, watched you produce all of this work over time that was making visible the infrastructure of the cloud and, you know, the cloud is actually a warehouse on the side of the M25. And there was like that moment when suddenly it was like, oh no, the cloud should be embraced as this symbol of unknowability. And I wonder if you can speak to that a little bit, because unknowability is like obviously an important threat,
yeah.
And how that kind of happened.
So, yeah, this thing you're talking about with the cloud. So I spent years playing with this big figure of the cloud, and I've been fascinated watching this thing turn from like a little symbol in electrical engineers' diagrams that was just like this kind of little thought bubble shape that slowly expanded to take the entire planet. Where now basically everything we do happens in this cloud. Like all your banking takes place in the cloud, all your social relationships are taking place in the cloud, we increase these things like vote in the cloud, all of these kind of huge civic things, which we used to have a quite strong kind of concrete sense of, sort of slowly have disappeared into this big, numinous, fuzzy thing. And so myself and a lot of artists, I guess, spent a lot of the last few years trying to bring it down to earth, right? Kind of being able to point at it, much like the exercise of the new aesthetic, like the structure, you can make you can read interesting new things in it. So in the book, for example, they talk about the fiber optic cable that carries internet around the world, and we have this lovely idea of the internet as this kind of incredibly contemporary emancipatory thing, but if you look at a map of the cables, they're the old steamer routes of empire, right? There's a fast, the internet cables from West Africa come to back, right? The internet connections in South America are still tightly tied to Spain. And there's a sense of which this kind of, that colonialism, which we sort of occasionally pretend we kind of push back, actually just kind of moved up into the level of infrastructure. And again, when you physicalize the cloud, these kind of cloudy terms, you can speak about those things a lot more directly and possibly learn from them and point that stuff again and say, once we know that, can we make it a little cloudy again? Because the central paradox of the book is that we seem to have kind of engineered our way to the end game of enlightenment, which is the idea that by producing, by storing, by transmitting and distributing ever more data about the world, by turning the world into just something to be read as data and computed, the enlightenment idea is that we will come to sort of some kind of utopian perfect vision that will make us all kind of better. And we've really been working at that. You know, we built this planetary scale infrastructure for transmitting all information everywhere to some people, not, certainly not everyone, as much as possible. And the result is not some kind of like coming together, but in fact seems to be a world completely riven by ever greater kind of divisions and fundamentalisms. So we kind of, this is what I mean by like listening to the network when it's trying to tell us something. Because it seems impossible to hold on to that belief in kind of data and quantification and kind of information for its own sake, when actually every time we test it against the world itself, that's where I start to kind of push towards this quality of unknowing, which is really a question of asking, like, what can we know, what can we think, and what can we do without purely relying on being kind of given an inherently flawed database model of everything.
Maybe this is too big a question, but it's like I'm curious, like how far you're prepared to take that argument in terms of, because it moves from being about technological systems the way to, and you cite the Enlightenment, it moves into a challenge to empiricism and rationality and the age of reason and et cetera, et cetera. And we're obviously going, well, I feel like it's obvious to some people that we're going through this moment in which you know, there's a re-enchantment of the world, and there are subjects that people are beginning to talk about that haven't been talked about for a long time. And I wonder whether it's like the book is saying we need to stop and look here, or whether how far push it?
I'm willing to push it quite far and see where it goes, because like I genuinely oppose to this every time I see the end result of these kind of data-based empirical processes being pushed that far, the result is either violent when it comes to things like surveillance and various types of modelling, the use of software for all kinds of and court-based decisions, these kind of examples, or it's actively failure. So speaking to like scientific empiricism directly, one of the kind of quite extended case studies I talk about in the book is the development of new medicine. And so in the last 20 years or so, medical research has intensely computerized and has turned into something that's entirely data-driven, where they've basically built vast, vast libraries of data about chemicals. And, you know, if you think about our kind of mental image of a laboratory of kind of people in white coats tinkering with jars and stuff has basically been entirely replaced by, at the cloud, right? By huge stacks of computers. And this is like one of the best funded kind of research areas on the planet. It's huge industry with cutting edge science and all this stuff. And yet, it's failing. In fact, the pharmaceutical industry's results are declining. They're discovering fewer and fewer drugs. And there's very various possibilities of this. But it's been discovered that one of the ways to counter that that decline, which is literally like a failure to find things within a space in its simplest thing. Like we know there are combinations of drugs out there, and the machines alone have not been able to find them. But yet, when you put humans back into that system again, something different happens. That there's a way of thinking, it seems, to the human, which is distinct from raw machine-driven empiricism. And that has been kind of increasingly occluded from our way of thinking by this thing that's got baked into our mind that the world is what is computable, and that we kind of not, we're incapable of thinking of things that don't fit into that model. So the answer is not, you know, the problem of pushback, the answer is not necessarily meditating in a cave, so I occasionally recommend that. It's actually just seeking to resist seeking like the dominance of one particular approach that we really have at this point in history, I feel like, stress tested to its limits, and we are starting to see the cracks.
Yeah, and maybe to give an example of that, I just wanted to like highlight two of the bits that had the most impact on me. One was, and then I guess they're both in the kind of the climate section. One was, I was sat on a plane, and there's a section that talks about the increase in turbulence as a result of more carbon in the atmosphere, and then lists out all of the injuries that have happened on planes. And ever since that moment, I've been like wearing a tight seatbelt on a plane at all times. But I guess, you know, that's like a practical thing. You know, keep your seatbelt on the plane, even if you're sleeping or whatever. It will save lives. But I guess there's more specific where in the book there's this constant like oscillation examples of texts that try and unpick kind of technological systems or take aim at specific things that are emerging, because it's through, as you read through the book, these feedback, you just get trapped in them, and it's one after another. And here's one for you. So I'll read this one. Carbon dioxide clouds the mind. It directly degrades our ability to think clearly, and we are walling it into our places of education and pumping it into the atmosphere. The crisis of global warming is a crisis of the mind, a crisis of thought, a crisis in our ability to think another way. Soon, we shall not be able to think at all. Which is like, when you're reading this next to the graph of like the current projected, it's like, oh, it's so much worse than I thought.
This is indeed the case. And the point I'm... So again, one of the things that I'm setting out in this book is to try and, yeah, ask how we think about these things when all of these things are true. The comparison in another chapter that I make to climate, between the climate and actually between and to global surveillance, I talk a lot about surveillance, and there's this bit where I talk about like whistleblowing and how much we know about surveillance and therefore how much we're capable of acting on it, and particularly reflecting on what is the same thing and many, many other stories. We've still yet to actually kind of grapple with this, and one of the reasons for that is there's a quote from Ronnie Horne, the artist in the book, who says that that weather is the central paradox of our age. Weather that's nice in the immediate is like bad at the systemic level, right? We climate change has poisoned our ability to have nice conversations about the weather, because it's always kind of looming there. Just as global surveillance has like made us like kind of coated our phones with this kind of like sticky, nasty stuff. And there's not that those we don't think it, right? We actually actively reject thinking about it. It becomes hard to think because it is that kind of deeply unpleasant. And I guess, though I know this is not something I said, but maybe the darkness that is a response to that. Like, ultimately, despite all the examples I give in this, like nothing is gained by knowing all of these facts about how many stations the NSA, PPM, CO2 in the atmosphere. Just as, in fact, you know, when the story I started my book with, like when Ruskin started writing his notebooks about how the weather had changed at the end of the 19th century, and he didn't know why it had changed. He says that like the rains got worse, his garden is spoiling, the clouds are darker in the sky. And he says this based on like studying 1,000 years of Western painting. But he picks up on various things, but he doesn't. And environmentalists have seized on the fact that this was the age of industrialization and chimneys were going up everywhere, and he mentions them. But actually, he doesn't really care about any of that stuff. What he says is that something is wrong in the times themselves. Right? This is a kind of some kind of animistic response to the unrest in the world itself. And that's what it feels to me in like unpacking these horrible scenarios, is that they're not really the point. The point is to say that like we have to be aware of something else that's awry, something else that's off kilter in our very way of thinking about the world. And it's in that sense that I invoke this idea of unknowing, of a kind of willful rejection of that form of kind of Western empirical knowing, because it's not helping us address these issues at all.
So I'm going to take a slightly different direction now, because I feel like we'd be doing the book something of a disservice if we didn't talk about AI. And I'm sure lots of people wanted to hear about AI this evening, because I feel like this is a hot topic. But you know, jokes aside, you have done an excellent job throughout the book and in ongoing work to elucidate how these systems work, the impact that they have, and the impact that we can't know as a result of black box neural networks and things like this. And throughout the book, you speak about things like Deep Blue, AlphaGo, YouTube algorithms that prey on children. We're not going to talk about that. Deep Dream. And I wondered, you know, in speaking about AI, I guess I just want to bracket it of what do you think is at stake? Because often a lot of your book and a lot of the work that you're looking at the moment kind of uses AI as this emblem or this symbol through which to talk about all of these subjects, but AI is also a kind of specific discourse. And I just wondered, given that your kind of in-depth knowledge of this subject, what do you think is at stake in the trajectory that's currently being laid out for the development of artificial intelligence?
I mean, I could give like several different answers to that. The one that I kind of come back to, well, you mentioned Deep Dream, and I just want to like to set scene. Actually, I just let's say something about Deep Dream before I get to that. Just everyone familiar with Deep Dream, the kind of like weird psychedelic imagery that Google came out with like 18 months ago, which they produced by like feeding their these neural networks they've developed for image classification, feeding them basically blank images or other images, and seeing, like trying to see what the machines were looking for in these images. And the thing that came out of that was like these crazily hallucinogenic kind of images of like kind of things, dogs with hundreds of heads, or like particularly, you know, loads of eyes, which is equally emblematic of like Google's, and thus these technologies' perception of the world as something to be kind of seen and imaged and, and kind of gathered in this way. And the thing about everyone was like, oh wow, like the computers are tripping balls. Like it was just this kind of very odd thing. And the thing is that like that was literally a nightmare, right? the guy I forget his surname, he's called Sergey, he's a Google engineer, like came up with Deep Dream in a dream. He dreamt it. But the dream was a nightmare. He then woke up and programmed it, came up with these images, showed them to the rest of the Google team, who were sort of like, whoa, dude, no, like, that is not cool. Like they then tried to get Google PR to release them, and Google PR were like, no, bury this in a box. And then they leaked online, right? And I have no idea how that happened, but then Google had to kind of own them and like put them out in the world. And then everyone was kind of like, ooh, that's crazy and tricky. But this is a thing that literally kind of emerged from a nightmare. And so I want to put that, and neural networks are not artificial intelligence, though there's some weird crossovers. They are somehow emblematic of this desire to bring computers into the realm of what we have considered to be human intelligence and human ways of thinking about the world. And they're, I emphasize the nightmare thing to say, they're not always coming from what we consider to be a rational place. Not that I, you know, think that much comes from a place of rationality, but a lot of this imagining really doesn't. And it comes from very odd and strange places, and it's okay to talk about it in that way, essentially, I think. So that's the deep dream thing. Where was I supposed to be going?
Trajectory.
The trajectory of that, okay. So,
I'd say, like, specifically, you know, the narrative that's being told around AI right now, whether it's, like, taking jobs, etc.
Thank you. What I was going to say about the trajectory, and the one that I kind of follow and find most interesting in the book, like, we can talk about military applications and we talk about all this kind of stuff, but the one I find most interesting is kind of continually asking, like, what it is we want it for, like, why we're making it, at a quite, like, broad kind of species level thing, because I actually, like, studied AI, kind of 15 years ago, when the last idea of what artificial intelligence would be was kind of falling out of favor. And at that time, it was largely around cognitive science, around linguistics, around evolutionary psychology, which has thankfully mostly gone away. But it was particularly this idea that we could build a computer that looked like the brain, that kind of was basically like a brain, and therefore would somehow magically be more humanly intelligent. And that approach really failed. And it's taken a while to come back to the current wave of AI that we hear about all the time. And that happens to human about this idea. We're going with something that's far more computationally based and kind of far more other. And so we're evolving, and so we basically hear about machine learning, about artificial intelligence these days. And there's a practical engineering reason for that is that machine learning isn't really intelligent. But the other thing is, it's also machinic. And to even use the term artificial intelligence is to, like, imply that it's, like, somehow a fake version of us when it's a real version of something completely different, which is weirdly destabilizing. And so, did I talk about the deep learning alpha go thing?
You may.
Thank you. The bit that this really particularly hit a match last year, when this computer beat Lisa Dole, one of the world's best Go players. And it was built as a kind of rerun of the Deep Blue Kasparov map from 97, which was this, you know, huge built-up man versus the machine thing, where the world's greatest, possibly ever, chess player was pitted against this computer that had been designed specifically to beat him. And it did, in a way that we fundamentally comprehend what Deep Blue did to beat Kasparov. And what it did was it basically kind of outgunned him in terms of the fact that it was capable of holding more board positions in its head. It's pretty simple memory storage capacity and kind of live memory than a human does. So it could think more moves ahead and it could see more outcomes and it just brute forced the problem. Go doesn't work like that. And that's what AlphaGo is. It's a neural network for machine learning system. And it was pitched against Lisa Dole. And in the third game, the first two games are relatively easily matched. And then in the third game, about halfway through the game, AlphaGo plays this move, which is unlike any move that's been seen before in Go. You know, a game which has this extraordinary history and strategies and all this kind of thing. It plays this wild, crazy move. And Lisa Dole's like actually leaves the room for like half an hour to think about it. The commentator, the speech, watch the kind of live thing, and commentators don't know what's safe for ages, and then they start discussing, like, oh, well, it's broken, like, it's a ridiculous move. And it takes, like, another little while of gameplay to see, this is one of the greatest Go moves that's ever been played. Like, no one has ever seen a move like this. Completely white. And the thing is, we will never know why it made that move. It's processes of thinking about the game and understanding the concept of Go itself are enmeshed in a neural network structure that is ultimately beyond any human brain's ability to map. We will never know what it was thinking. Which is sad, right? On another level, it's beautiful. Like, the machines are like opening up this extraordinary territory that was never accessible to us before. But they're gonna do a lot of it without us. And again, like, in many ways, fine, okay, but that's what's at stake. Like, the thing I would tip over into slightly is also to say, we're really, really, really bad at considering the urgencies and agencies of non-human things. That's a big part of why we're in the horrific mess we're in now. It's bad enough how we treat each other, but like how we treat the planet, how we treat other species, is a big part of like the kind of inherent violence that, that humanity seems all too willing to demonstrate. And so this thing that I keep circling around, like what is technology here to teach us? Like maybe it's one of the things we're gonna have to do is raise these little robot friends, or killer death robots, or whichever one we're like gonna we're deciding we wanna build, and gonna have to learn to live with it and learn, you know, how to work with and cooperate and think alongside and acknowledge the presence of other intelligences, other agencies. And you know, one hope might be that that actually makes us better.
I'm going to skip my question on the AI arms race.
Okay.
I think it's something that I really want to get to, so I'm conscious of time. So how am I going to quickly speak through AI? There's something about myth in your book that's not been, I don't think it's been dealt with enough, that it hasn't necessarily been kind of brought to the surface in other conversations. But before we get there, I guess there's interesting set of dialogues that were developed around the Summertime Marathon, and particularly Kenneth McDowell talking about the idea, what we can see happening in Silicon Valley with the development of AI, but predominantly it's been based on a kind of Judeo-Christian belief model, and this is why we end up with the narratives. But we can't see that because Silicon Valley, for the most part, presents itself as atheist or agnostic. And you know, to speed through in terms of kind of myth and thinking that through, maybe in response to some of these specific points, at the same moment as we have that kind of illumination and the return of belief, return of religion, we begin to reframe our relationship to artificial intelligence in like, well, maybe we shouldn't actually treat it like an evil kind of god, because that might replicate existing narratives of control. At the same time, we're seeing this really interesting thing emerge with respect to kind of divinatory practices. So like AI presents itself as a tool that can predict the future quite often, but it too often actually just mirrors the past back and pretends it's the future. And in this kind of return of divinatory practices, you're seeing like a huge rise of people paying attention to astrology and kind of, you know, tarot, things like this. And I just wondered, I mean, you kind of swerve around the edges of this subject, and I know that it's something of interest, but I just wondered that kind of polarity of the kind of like super technical rational systems versus the return of belief, and you know, there's a lot there.
Yeah.
And I'm compacting four questions into one, but I guess, if what are your thoughts on that?
It's like interesting magical times right now. And that's good. I said that as someone who basically think on some level that I invoked the whole new aesthetic crisis by repeatedly putting a slide to Aleister Crowley up every time that I talked about it, as a way of talking about what happens when you name things. And that there's a history to doing that that's valid and interesting. The kind of, do we have a term for it yet? The kind of like magical, mystical awakening or whatever it is, this kind of constellation of thought that seems to be going on at the moment and producing lots of really interesting artistic and theoretical work. I see, possibly, this is my reading of it at the moment, is that it's actually an attempt to like reassert agency over those things that we don't understand, right? Because ultimately so much of human history, and particularly of religious and ritual history and mystic history and all this kind of stuff, is basically like how you propitiate systems that you don't understand, you know? I think there's a direct line thrown back to attempts to kind of reassert agency in the present. Which is not to say that those things are meaningless. I don't mean that by any stretch of the imagination. I think there's a huge amount of power and thought in them. And as I say repeatedly in the book, this kind of ability to, like, literally, how do we live amongst vast and dangerous systems that we don't understand? Because the whole idea was that we were taming everything, right? And we were making it all like safe and good and things we don't have to worry about. And now we're inviting, you know, things into our homes and into our pockets that we don't understand and that may contain all kinds of strange dangers.
And if we don't understand them, we need some way of balancing that. And so mystical practices have always been a way of asserting agency in a situation you don't understand. And I think that's a really productive way to think about it. But the other thing that I talk about in the book is also like how you give voice to and acknowledge and live alongside like simply other ways of telling these stories and other ways of thinking about them. One of the stories I talk about in the book, which I took from Susan Shipley's work, is her accounting and some other authors' accounting of certain First Nations people who have been about the... they've been saying that the earth is off its axis. And what happened, this really interesting thing that Susan Shipley documents in one of her works, is that a few years ago, a bunch of First Nations people were invited to the COP16, the big climate conference, and were basically as these sort of like native witnesses to the problem, like, you know, bring these people access because it like weirds out scientists. And they were said it was off the axis because the sun is setting in a different place. Like the land has changed to a radical degree. Something is afoot on the planet, and this was how they ended it. And they continued to insist upon this. And it's possible to say that they are, the atmosphere is filling with dirt and particles that weren't there before, and it's doing that most at higher latitudes. And the same sunsets that you see go red over like smoggy cities, because of like more crap in the atmosphere, are affecting higher latitudes more, right? So of course things look differently at the poles than they did before. But at the same time, like I think it's really essential to resist just going like, oh, but they mean this when we say it in scientific terms. That like to actually engage with this stuff thoughtfully and critically, it's really necessary to hold both those ways of talking about what's happening kind of equally with equal value and with equal amounts of thought, because it's quite clear from our inability to act, okay, that our dominant ways of talking about it are radically insufficient. So the urge in the book is to kind of constantly seek out different ways of talking about what is happening. With, you know, whatever tools you have to hand, frankly, you know, use whatever's in the pouch to like to talk and think about this thing.
So I just want to give a few examples, and I'm conscious of time questions. So it's interesting in the complexity, the conclusion to the complexity chapter, you invoke Hermes as the complexity. At other stages in the book, you invoke kind of Thor and Thor's hammer and the ability to view objects as metaphor. And perhaps my favorite kind of myth-making, and this is specific to the question, but perhaps you can talk about the use of those other myths, is the example given of the priesthoods in ancient Egypt during the annual ceremony of Osiris. Perhaps you can explain this example, but the question is like how they executed control and how there are parallels to the kind of systems of control that are present in the world in this moment.
I mean, yeah.
Maybe explain
this is
what
just
happens.
This is just ancient power at work. Like from the moment we developed technology, it was used by those in power against those without it in various forms. And if you don't know this example, it's the fact that Egypt built a millennia-long dynasty of extraordinary power and wealth that was very violent to most of its subjects, that placed all of its wealth and power at the very center in the most extraordinary, elaborate, kind of mythic structure that, one of the most extraordinary ones anyway, that the planet has probably ever known. This just vast repositories of storytelling and myth and all of this thing. And at the heart of this was the pharaohs and everything else had a series of secret wells along the Nile in which over centuries they marked how high it rose so that every year they were capable of predicting based on the rising tide whether that year would be a drought or a flood, a catastrophic flood, or like a good year in between.
and that they could use that as a way of controlling the populace. They could set taxes and do all this kind of stuff, but they could also perform these incredible rituals of kind of summoning and all of these kind of, they really even understood could exist. That actually kind of precedes all of this talking about myth, really. But it's really about this point of realizing that technology is, it's right back to what I said at the start about realizing the kind of struggle that's inherent in thinking about technology, and also pointing out that this is really not new in any way, right? This has always been the way these things use. But to say that technologies are always held and kept secret to some extent, and will always be used against those with less power and less understanding, which is part of a kind of wider thread in the book of talking about the kind of absolute necessity of democratizing, for want of a better term, technology, but also crucially understanding of technology. One of the problems I kind of address in the book is how do we all talk about technology, in a way that all of us can get involved in this conversation. Because we've always known priesthoods are, we haven't, but it's always been proved in the long run that priesthoods are a bad idea. We're heavily invested in a kind of technological priesthood right now. So the necessity of working out pretty rapidly how we pull back from that is the story of the dilemma.
Thank you, James. I think we're thriving.
Thanks so much for the conversation. I wanted to ask, because Ben started by saying it's unusual for you to write a book because you've done so many things in your practice. I was also very curious if this book will lead to another book, or if it's a one-off.
I super hope so. I really like writing. So the reason that's, there's kind of 10 years of silly things that I've done on the internet in this book. Also, this book makes sound like a memoir, but it sort of is. So it's I'm a bit nervous of of building up that kind of load. I think that has to be, not least because, in this book, I made a very, very firm decision not to solutionize, essentially. Not to tell anyone what they should be doing. Not to propose any of the magic solutions for this, but simply to state what I saw as kind of present conditions of all, because I don't think they're being stated very clearly very often. And it's weird that I use that term clear when I'm deliberately also clouding. I'm going to do the same as kind of equal if possible. I'm not going to stop writing. I don't know if there'll be more books, but this is the statement.
Only
read to
take the question from the narrator, and then the second question.
Thanks for that. It's really interesting. As you know, we've talked about it. I've read the book, and just also with you mentioning some examples here in terms of the First Nations people understanding of climate change and the movement of the sun, but also the scientists grasp maybe the medical labs, which go beyond the original, and might be something almost intuitive. So I was thinking about this as being almost a call to pay more attention to embodied knowledge and the experience that is kind of bodily and held, which is of course something that feminist theorists have been talking about for a long time. But at the same time, and obviously this is also one of the things that's missing from AI, isn't it? This idea of a kind of disembodied brain. What it's missing is maybe embodied knowledge. But at the same time, of course, all of this is being quite aggressively researched, isn't it, in Silicon Valley in terms of effective computing and quantifying the voice and feelings. And so I was wondering if you've got any thoughts on kind of how that embodied knowledge can be held without also then monetizing it and kind of controlling it and turning it into another thing to control a kind of wider population.
Yeah, I don't have the answer of how it can be held, but I think it's really worth emphasizing, as you've said, that this there's a lot missing from this, because it's missing from my own knowledge of coming to this largely from a kind of technological concern
having, that like many of the questions in here have been like very, very well sketched and addressed by feminist thinkers and queer thinkers and a number of other people in very important ways. And one of the things I mentioned, it's like half a line, but I thought it was really important, was to say, when I rant grandly about the new dark age, is that many people have always lived in darkness of various forms. And by which, again, I don't mean lack of knowledge, I mean where they're not being spoken of, or their contribution is not realized in all these kind of ways. You could read the whole book, maybe it's not all computers, how ridiculously belated that kind of realization is. I don't know enough about the practices that you're talking about at all to say how they can be like held away from the things that they're eating everything else, because you said they're already not there. What by certain voices and other perspectives, it's like even though I write on the internet as much as possible, and like it's this dark, grim place of fighting often, particularly at the moment, it's also a place in which amazing flowerings of identity and self-presentation are occurring, because it does convey a certain visibility on things that were hidden before, and that's an amazing thing for me to see. I have no, the how we admit other voices and other storytelling. I want to, because I just read it, mention another book, which is Claire Evans's Broadband, which is like in the first chapter of the book, mm-hmm. I talk about a history of computers and how they were built and how they were developed, and it's a very, very partial history. And then Claire Evans's book Broadband, which has just come out, she talks, it's a history of the women who built the internet, essentially. And it's just ridiculous how few of these stories have been told up to now, and how central they are, and how this history, like the actual contribution from those narratives as well. Like, you just don't know what's happened, right, until that other set of the history is told. Also, it's a radically different history, in that it's one that's not focused on, like, necessarily who wrote one line of code or who built this computer. It's also who were the community builders of the early internet, like who was creating a community, the really key part of that is a history of various internet communities that, like, also the internet wouldn't have happened. It wasn't just, nerds in Silicon Valley, it was the people who lived it and experienced and embodied it. So I don't know what the answer is to it, but I'm pleased to see that there's many, many ways of kind of writing it out to make it visible.
Thank you. Is this the same? Maybe you can hear me anyway. You alluded when talking about the AlphaGo experiment, and then your work on children's programming, which you're talk about, but the rather brilliant piece on Peppa Pig and the self-replicating algorithms that appear to be outside human control. And I just wonder whether this is connected in any way to what fellow visionaries like Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking said before he died, that the greatest threat to humanity is AI. Is that something you subscribe to, and is there a possibility that this becomes unstoppable and out of control?
So the question, if that's the microphone wasn't doing it, is given some of the examples we talked about the other day, and stuff I talked about YouTube in the book, like basically is there a chance for some kind of like breakthrough of AI, like Stephen Hawking warned, like Elon Musk, who, but as people have warned. I mean, yeah, but it sounds really flip, but I really should say this, like, we already have artificial intelligences living amongst ourselves, and they're called corporations. We already created very complex, algorithmically run intelligent systems that operate, and if we put the AI inside a huge battle bot with machine guns on it, like, that's the danger. Or if we put it, if it tries to turn everyone into paperclips, like, that's a real possibility and a danger. AI is a really interesting thought experiment, which is not to say that it's not going to happen for real,
But like for me, my interest in it is as a framework for thinking about, yeah, about the non-human, about complex systems, about things that are not within the control or even the full understanding of any one, certainly not one individual or even any one group or any kind. I think we have much bigger things to worry about than the like soon emergence of a like malevolent AI. Like worry about it all we want, but like I'd rather think about it in terms of how by thinking about AI we can think about a lot of other like really big systemic issues that have been with us for some time and are doing a you know much more damage in the present.
I've got more questions just in case.
Okay, I haven't quite formulated this question, but it's now 10 degrees hotter than it was 100 years ago because of tube trains just running constantly, like, you know, 65 days a year. The heat from those trains actually made the whole of it change, you know, the geography of the underground central London. And I have some kind of mixed feelings about that because obviously the tube were driving, but then, you know, how do you feel about, you know, the sort of dependence, like this creeping dependence on new technology? I mean, obviously the tube's not new as such, but it's that kind of feeling that the more we use it as a crutch, the more we will depend on it.
This is the central paradox. I mean, I don't even want you to come in on this one because, ultimately, that question for me, and maybe I'm wrong about this, like presupposes like either it's kind of acceleration into we all build death, or like go back to, like the answer is going to be, you know, somewhere between those things. And we're not going to magically fix that thing. The thing that I focus on, as I've said, is how we see the ways in which the technologies we're dependent upon have been, the ways in which they've been developed, right? So whether they've been developed kind of originally as military systems and brought into civilian life, whether they've been developed as kind of industrial corporate systems, what are the logics that have put this particular configuration of technologies in place? And how, given that we're not going on making stuff, do we make stuff in ways that like is at least not the way we've been doing it thus far? Because we can see the outcomes of the way in which those things have been produced so far and the logics that have underpinned them. And we're seeing the results of those things. And so, yeah, the main thing I concentrate on in response to that question is how do we open up wider participatory people's agency to be part of that process? That's.
I mean, for me to respond.
I really want your opinion.
I think the reason you want me to say something is just because my response to a lot of this has not necessarily been to try and work through. I guess maybe it's like taking something of an embodied like approach of like how does one examine a dating practice and how can you exit through, in some ways, like how can you exit out technology through the body? And I think, you know, there was a Ted Kaczynski thing in here that I didn't bring into the conversation, but Ted Kaczynski is an important, and that, I don't support the Unabomber. But Ted Kaczynski is like a really important figure in terms of like seeing the very, I mean, he must, like, how did he do it? He saw very early on the potential in cybernetic thought and the RAND Corporation, everything that this was going to lead to, and he took a very extreme approach. He went to, you know, he went to the countryside and made bombs, and that's not something to advocate for. But it's interesting that we're trapped in this kind of conundrum of like, in my own work, I've attempted to go into the countryside with a bunch of techno-utopians and try and work through like a different thing about the kind of attention economy and things like this. But I don't know how I can speak directly to this question without like unpacking all of the kind of weird stuff that I'm going through personally, respecting this practice. But so, like, I would personally like gesture very much towards looking at monasticism as like not necessarily sitting in a cave meditating, but looking at the way in which a structured life, the bare life, combines work and life, and how that shift in form of living, it allows you to inform a set of decisions over time. The monasteries give rise to, you know, time, keeping, you know, all of the many different agricultural processes as a result of like living out a different structure of life. And I think that that's kind of what we need to do. And I think that within what we've been given, if we do return to the kind of cybernetic discourse of design patterns and things like that, there is the potential to take some of these bits apart, put them together to form something else. And I'm not sure why we're not doing it. I put it down to Saturn and Capricorn, and I think in 2021, but there is this kind of moment coming, yeah. And that we will like re-establish our agency once we understand kind of the, well, I think this is a moment of just a reckoning.
One of the things that the imaginative leap that one of the things I think is fascinating about the conversation around the network and the idea that it's this scale tool for introspection that you know, that our species has created. You say this phrase, and I think it's just a very surprising way of thinking that just opens up. And creates a kind of new space.
Like planetary scale tool for introspection is the thing. One of the weird things about the internet is that no one set out to create it, and no one knows what it's for. People were building all of these bits of things, but we created this vast network, right? Which is encompasses everything, it's expanded out to the scale of the planet. And we did it unconsciously. And now we make more and more stuff with it that we also do partially by accident, by kind of poking and prodding it. And I call it, in the book, an unconsciously generated tool for unconscious generation. And I refuse to believe it doesn't have some kind of purpose. Right? Not in a teleological sense, not in the sense that like it's been sent from God to direct us, but like we can use it for stuff. And the very least we could do is use it to think about ourselves.
As you mentioned, I think I have a loud voice. One or the other. As you mentioned, teleological, and you know, we talk quite a lot about your title, about the new dark age, and you declare being optimist means at the same time. And by now we know that dark age, probably they were not that dark. What I want to concentrate is a bit the end of the future.
What's that? Where that part of the title comes from is actually one of the real triggers for the book. And actually from the title as well, which I read an article in the paper called The Title New Dark Age, before I even came across a lot of artwork. And it was an article by someone who runs the American Weather Corporation, which is one of the largest US-based weather forecasters in the world, and one that kind of pioneered the use of data pioneered the information to feed ever more powerful computer programs in order to be able to predict the weather. What's happening, there's a lot of meteorological stuff in the book, and I cite a lot of the development of computation, and this, even the thinking about the future itself is this kind of process of divining the weather. But what's increasingly apparent is that despite all of our data and all of this information, our ability to predict the weather is starting to falter again. It's taken us about 100 years to get good weather forecasting out to about 7 to 10 days, which is pretty, we can see 7 to 10 days into the future. That's amazing. But unfortunately, climate change and the increased instability of the planet means that our models aren't working as well anymore. And we're getting more and more freak weather events and these kind of strange occurrences. It sounds kind of mystical, but it just means that things are more complicated than we're capable of modeling. And so that horizon of predictability is starting to come back towards us again. We're going to be, our weather forecasting is going to get worse. And this is how forecasting. And so much of our kind of complex, technologized society is entirely dependent upon our attempt to predict the future in various ways, whether that's moving goods around, whether that's sewing, any of these things. You know, it's the ability to predict the future is something we've based you know, contemporary society entirely upon. That's going to get worse. It's going to degrade. It's going to restrict. And so, the end of the future doesn't mean like there's not going to be a tomorrow. It means we're just not going to be able to think so much in terms of like what we're going to be doing in a week's time. I mean, it was which in turn becomes for me an insistence upon thought and care in the present. I related directly to Aldous Huxley and his insistence at all times on means and not ends, right? On the fact that any philosophy, which includes a philosophy of putting all the data into the computer, munging it, and doing what it says based on what it predicts will happen, that's what Huxley always says, means determine ends. And so the means are what we have in the present. The means are what we can do now for one another, and how we behave right now. And the future is not there for us to grasp in that way anymore. So we need to think more carefully about how we behave right now.
Do we have any other questions?
I need to tell you because you are trying the best. I see we have always tried the best for ourselves, but all the people, how we can, if everybody have their environment, their ability, and if everyone who's their job or profession and so on with responsibility could be better, not on the end.
Yeah, I mean, and I think we live in a time when that is increasingly undeniable. It's undeniability is the term that I keep coming back to. Like as I said, the way in which the kind of complex technologies are showing us that this kind of data-driven stuff, or as a way of understanding the world, is fundamentally broken. It's also starting to prove some super interesting results around like community, democracy of understanding. The thing I'm slightly obsessed with at the moment, I think probably this might be the last story, so I'm going to tell it quickly. What others have called the technology of ancient democracy. In the center of Athens, they've still got preserved one of these machines, which is a machine for selecting who was going to be in charge of the city. Most of ancient Athenian democracy was run by lot, which is a thing that's kind of gone from our democracy. But most of the offices of state were actually filled by a lottery of everyone who was eligible, which certainly wasn't everyone, but was a chunk of the population. They weren't voted for, they were selected at random. This has started to fade out of our society. It didn't basically exist in any more jury service. And underlying a lot of scientific research in the form of kind of randomized stochastic processes and so on and so forth, that randomness has this amazing process. And it turns out in a huge amount of technological processes, particularly in various forms of AI, particularly in kind of genetic algorithms and these kind of rather emergent forms of problem solving, that different forms of ability, different viewpoints, different understandings of the world are better at solving problems than any other method we have of figuring out who should be in charge or which particular approach to take. There's a thing. Kind of population for any kind of complex variegated task, you'll get a better result than if you try and select for any particular individual ability. And that should be really obvious, right? But we seem to be at this point where, you know, we need this kind of like mathematical modelling of the thing that I want to completely disavow. But it should be super obvious, a diversity of opinion and thought as possible, and being better in the present is a better long-term strategy than any other.
Okay, so are there any burning questions that would be like the worst thing in your life being asked?
Or you can also follow up with me outside shortly after.
So I think you mentioned, keeping on track, you wanted to say a little bit about why we invited Erica this evening, and also because now we're going to also see a film, so I thought now's an opportune moment to say a little bit about that, and then...
Particularly thank you to Erica and to Helen and Haroon for being part of this. I asked them because it's fantastic to show more work, and because sometimes, you know, when I'm just talking about the book, it's really important to bring in other, as you said, other perspectives, other ways of talking and thinking that are not so language bound in various ways, or that explore language in other ways. Erica's indication, I won't say too much about it because it's a work in itself, but I felt Erica's approach has always struck me as a way of engaging bodily and in an embodied fashion with in some cases these technologies, and that was the aspect of a much more complex practice that I thought would be interesting in this context. Regarding There Are His film, We Help Each Other Grow, it's a film they've been kind enough to show in a couple of exhibitions that I've curated, and is a work of incredible beauty and power, and you can read more about the specifics of it in the programme you've got. But yes, again, I kind of wanted to show it to basically say, these elements of kind of incredible technology and show how they can be used in kind of incredibly humane and thoughtful ways. And again, that's just one small aspect of a practice and an artwork, but it's kind of what I wanted to bring to the kind of closing moments of this, to say, other ways of thinking and reacting and talking about these things are possible, and that they can be, in this case, doing these.